of science is a very modern one. In fact, until the development of modern science, any intellectual that was interested in unraveling the mysteries of the natural world were in fact called natural philosophers, not scientists. The idea of the scientist as separate, distinguished from philosophers, is a creation from the 18th century, which was caused due to a difference in the nature of the job of the scientist or the previous natural philosopher. There was a change in the nature of the job that was caused by a change in the structure of scientific endeavor, if we can call it like that. That led to some interesting developments on the role of the scientist. Now, science became much more standardized, much more bureaucratic, so to speak, due to these changes. Universities, scientific organizations, journals, scientific journals, they created certain protocols, certain processes that had to be standard and had to be observed by all scientists in order for their work to meet the criteria that is established by these organizations. That is directly linked to the rise of empiricism, and especially in the form of logical positivism in the beginning of the 20th century. That is the modern idea of the scientific method comes from, and I'll let the great Richard Feynman explain what the scientific method is.
In general, we look for new law by the following process. First, we guess it. Then we well, don't laugh, that's the really true. Then we compute the consequences of the guess to see what, if this is right, if this law that we guessed is right, we see what it would imply. And then we compare those computation results to nature, or we say compare to experiment or experience, compare it directly with observation to see if it works. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. In that simple statement is the key to science. It doesn't make any difference how beautiful your guess is. It doesn't make any difference how smart you are, who made the guess, or what his name is. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. That's all there is to it.
Feynman's explanation here is a gross simplification of the method. But there is an important thing here, which is it is experimentation. It is the predictive power of a theory, the capacity to predict the results of an experiment. What will determine whether a theory is true or false, according to the scientific method? Now, there are two things to unravel from this explanation. One is related to the practical, to the methodological side of it, and the other is related to the philosophical side of it, to the epistemic side of it, and the definition of what is knowledge and what is truth. I have already made a video about peer reviewing and explaining the process and why it's important to science. But for the purpose of this video here, it's important to recognize one thing about peer reviewing. It is a very bureaucratic process. It's a very rigid process, and there are certain protocols, certain standards that have to be met in order for a journal to be, for a paper to be published in a journal. Currently in science, it's usually statistics that is used as the main element for methodology. You're going to draw an experiment, you're going to find correlations according to statistics, and then apply a theory to explain your correlations. That is how it usually works. But there is a problem with that, of course. Statistics is not 100% reliable. There can be problems with sample size, there can be problems with controls, or can be problems with bad instrumentation. There are many problems that can occur in this sort of experiment, and there is, of course, the problem of people manipulating data. Now, statistics on their own, they are useless. They don't really tell us much. They only show correlations. You need a theory in order to understand and interpret those correlations. And since we're talking about theory, you get more into the realm of philosophy. And then things start getting a little bit more fuzzy. And that leads to the question, what makes a theory true? Now, this is something that philosophers of science still argue to this day. There is not one objective criteria to determine that. And that is one of the most fascinating things about science and about philosophy of science. Now, one thing that I found particularly interesting about science is that the most fundamental the science is, the most reliance it has on mathematics. Because that also leads to problems. And I have a video already addressing this about how mathematics should not be described as a language of nature, how that is a rather silly approach to mathematics. Mathematics is simply a language that is describing natural phenomena. But the thing about mathematics, and that is so interesting about it, is that it's in simplicity, it is extremely accurate describing phenomena. In the words of Red's rhetoric,
math is reality, so long as you do math properly.
Because if not done properly, your calculations are going to be imprecise. They are going to be inaccurate. And in fundamental sciences, accuracy is the most important thing. Your precision in calculations in physics is what is going to allow engineers to build a safe bridge. We need that precision that mathematical models give. However, less fundamental sciences rely less on mathematics. To use an example of one of the most successful theories in the history of science, Darwin's theory of evolution through natural selection. It doesn't depend much on mathematics at all to be proven true. Now, what is considered evidence and proof of Darwin's theory are the predictions that Darwin has made. For example, the transition of fossils, the place of fossils in stratum, for example, in geological stratum. The very specific prediction that Darwin made of a moth with a very long tongue in Madagascar that was required in order to suck the nectar of a particular orchid. Now, these are all very precise and very bold predictions that Darwin made in his theory, and they have been confirmed by observation, not by mathematics, but by observation of the natural world. And that is what led to Darwinism take over the biological sciences and become the standard theory, and take over the Aristotelian view of biology that until the end of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century, we're still dominating the field of biology. It's because Darwinism is capable of making better predictions of phenomena and more simplistic explanations for the observed phenomena, and that is more in line with other theories from other disciplines, especially geology, for example. And the element of simplicity is very important, because simplicity is the application of the principle of the Occam's razor. So Darwinism relied less on assumptions, relied less on having to make some concessions to what it seems reasonable in order to make explanations of reality that in the Aristotelian model you had to make. So it's clear Darwinism has advantages compared to the Aristotelian model of biology. But can we say that Darwinian evolution is true? That is a much more complicated question to answer. The nature of truth is one of the oldest debates in the history of philosophy. In Raphael Sanzio's fresco, The School of Athens, is one of the most famous depictions of this debate. It shows in the center Aristotle and Plato discussing that very nature. What is truth? Plato with his more idealistic approach, more based on rationality, and Aristotle more with his empirical approach, more based on observation of natural phenomena. A more contemporary version of this debate was the debate between two prominent epistemologists in the 20th century, Karl Popper and Thomas Kuhn. Now, Karl Popper's main objective in his philosophy was trying to eliminate the problem of induction, Hume's problem of induction, from science. And he argued that what separates science from pseudoscience, from non-science, is that science is not trying to always prove itself right, but on the contrary, it's constantly trying to prove itself wrong. It's constantly trying to falsify its hypothesis. In Popper's view, when a biologist is doing research, what they are trying to do is to disprove Darwinian evolution. They're trying to falsify it. And when they fail to do so, is when they confirm that Darwinian evolution is true. If they manage to falsify it, that means that there are problems with the theory, and the theory is false. The problem, of course, with this view from Popper, that's not how science actually works. And as we've seen before, when we rely especially on statistical and correlational data, there are going to be distortions. This cannot be, it cannot be eliminated. They're always going to happen. And a null or a negative result doesn't actually mean that the theory is completely wrong. You cannot discard a theory just because one research didn't confirm it. So it is very clear that a scientific theory cannot be simply discarded because one research didn't confirm it. It's not how science works, or not the ideal way of how science should work. Science should account for possible mistakes. And this is a problem that Thomas Kuhn saw in Popper's argument. Now, a big difference between Kuhn and Popper is that Kuhn was an actual scientist. He was a physicist. And he saw that Popper's ideas were not how science worked and were impractical. But he saw the idea of falsifiability a very good one, and in fact a good way to separate science from pseudoscience. Even though the idea of falsifiability is great, you still cannot eliminate the problem of induction with falsifiability. Because, as we have already seen, research can find false negatives, can find false null results, and it can find false positives. You cannot eliminate this process, and ultimately it's going to be induction that is going to tell whether a theory is good or bad. The more prevalence of positive results, of scientists getting things right, is what is going to make a scientific theory accepted as true. Another important contribution of Kuhn was to recognize the standardized and bureaucratic process of day-to-day science. Unlike the vision of Popper of scientists constantly trying to falsify theories, that is not how scientists actually operate in the real world. In the real world, they're trying to solve specific problems, and they apply the standard theory of a field in order to explain their findings. And this stage is what Kuhn called normal science. And this is basically what happens. A student, a young student, goes to university, to college, etc., to learn a particular field. And they are somewhat indoctrinated, and this is Kuhn's words, to learn the theories of a particular field, and they are taught to accept them as true. And this is what Kuhn called a paradigm. A paradigm is not necessarily one theory, but the whole body of theories and of knowledge that is assumed as true by a field of science, and that students are taught to believe as true. And they are not really taught to start questioning and falsifying them on a regular basis. No, they're saying that this is what has been studied, and this is what has been found, and this is what is how we understand that reality works, and how these particular fields interpret natural phenomena. And this is what meant by indoctrination, is that they are not going to go through every single possible theory of a particular field, but they are actually taught to assume that the dominant theory that is almost by consensus accepted as true is true. This is how it usually works in university. Now, during the stage of normal science, the paradigm is assumed as true. Science to business as usual, and eventually certain results are going to show. They are not going to confirm the theory, but they are going to be discarded as either false negatives or false null reports. But suddenly, these anomalies start to accumulate. And that's when science starts to see that the theory is no longer being capable of making the same predictions that it used to be. It's not as accurate as it used to be. And they start to observe a problem in the theory. The theory is starting to fail. One of the common things that cause that is better technology that allows scientists to make more accurate research, more accurate experiments. And the more accurate the experiments, they start showing some flaws in the theory. The theory cannot predict everything that is going to be measured in the experiment with a more advanced technology. We can kind of say that this is the stage of physics at the moment, because you have two competing theories. You have quantum mechanics and relativity. Now, relativity explains a lot of things about natural phenomena. It explains gravity especially, while quantum mechanics explains the subatomic world, explains how subatomic particles work, but they are incompatible. And this is a problem in physics, because that implies that one of them, or perhaps both of them, are wrong, or are not entirely true. They are useful to predict accurately predict and describe certain phenomena, but not all of them. That means that there is something wrong with them. And when these anomalies keep accumulating so much that it starts to become a problem to science, and scientists can no longer really trust the theory, is when the field enters a stage of crisis. Now, that was clearly the stage of Aristotelian biology by the 18th, 19th century. It could no longer explain or accurately predict a lot of things that we knew about the natural world. So new theories were necessary. The biology needed better ideas, better theories capable of explaining what was being observed. And that is when Lamarck came with his theory of inheritance, and Darwin came with his theory of evolution through natural selection. You had these two competing theories trying to explain natural phenomena. And when it was clear among biologists that Darwinian evolution through natural selection was capable of making better predictions, of making more simplistic explanations of the observed phenomenon, and were more in line with other theories from other fields, is when biologists finally assumed that Darwinian evolution was the way to go. And this is what made Darwinian evolution the standard theory of biology, and that is what led to a paradigm shift, which is the fourth stage, according to Kuhn, to Darwinian evolution. Darwinian evolution became the new paradigm in biology. And when that paradigm shift occurs, and the field agrees upon the new paradigm as being the new standard from now on, that's when you go back to the stage of normal science, and the whole cycle starts again, or not. And that is the thing. It might not start again. It might be the case that, in the case of biology, Darwinian evolution is that it's what it is. And we never will come up with a better model. So far, we haven't. But to answer the question that I made before, can we say that Darwinian evolution is true? Well, some of you probably are not going to like my answer to that. My answer is, I don't know. We don't know. And we cannot possibly know. Not in an absolute sense anyway. Because what Kuhn has shown us is that science is not absolute, and it is a mistake to assume that a scientific theory is absolutely true, that it cannot never be proven false. Now, how I like to put it is that Darwinian evolution is a scientific truth. It is true according to scientific epistemology. And I would agree with Papa that what separates scientific claims and theories from non-scientific is the element of falsifiability. And this might sound a bit contradictory or counterintuitive, but the fact that science can be proven wrong is a guarantee that it is possibly right. If something cannot be proven wrong, it can't be proven right either. And we have to accept it on blind faith. It's a guess that we cannot test it. And it's important for science to maintain that capability of being tested, of being verified. Let's use here an example of a non-scientific or pseudo-scientific truth. Freudian's Oedipus complex theory. Why is this a pseudo-scientific truth? Well, because it cannot be proven wrong. I cannot know whether it's true or false because I cannot test it. Why do I say that? Well, if you are familiar with the theory, it means that every child has sexual attraction towards their opposite sex parents. So boys are sexually attracted to their mothers and girls are sexually attracted to their fathers. Now, to test that, what Freud did was to talk with his patients, especially about their dreams, and he started to find out certain cues that his patients were having sexual desire for the opposite sex parent. He concluded that that is the case with everybody. Some people, however, even in his own testing, didn't show any sort of attraction to the opposite sex parent. So what was Freud's answer to that? He said that they were repressing their Oedipus complex. So no matter whether you've shown attraction or not, you have an Oedipus complex. That makes the theory unfalsifiable. I can never test whether it's true or false, because no matter what answer I give to Freud, I'm going to have an Oedipus complex. It's either repressive or it's not. Now, it doesn't mean that Freud is wrong. Freud could be right, but there is no way to test whether he's right or wrong, because no matter what the results of the experiment or the test is, it will always confirm the theory, and that's what makes the theory pseudo-scientific or a non-scientific theory, because it cannot be proven either right or wrong. That is the beauty of science, because it can be proven wrong, it can improve, we can learn from it, and we can increase our knowledge of the world using science. The element of falsifiability, it's what's going to separate science from pseudoscience or from non-science. It is the best method of learning things about reality that we know of. And we shouldn't simply discard it because it is not absolutely, it's no way to absolutely prove that it's true. Because the very idea of unquestionable truth is questionable. I cannot prove that I am not a brain in a vat. I cannot prove that I am stuck in a matrix. I cannot prove any of those things. But no one can prove to me that I am a brain in a vat. No one can prove to me that I am stuck in a matrix. These are all unfalsifiable claims. They don't teach me anything about the world at all. Because the fact is, we experience reality subjectively. Everything that I know is a creation of my brain. I assume that external reality is real. I cannot prove that it is real, but I cannot prove that it is not. I simply assume it. And after I make that assumption, I can actually start working with people and trying to solve problems that I perceive that we all share, that we all see and have in common. So if I smell gas in my house, I ask my housemate, I ask my friend, if they smell it too, I get their confirmation. If I see something that seems odd, I ask someone to confirm if they're actually seeing that too, if it's not a hallucination. And this is a process that we learn from the moment we are born. We are always doing that. And yet, that leads to the problem of induction. It's part of the problem of experience being subjective, and we cannot eliminate that. It's a problem that it's unsolvable, in my opinion. I don't think it's possible to solve that problem. But there are ways that we can, if not eliminate the problem, we can minimize it, and we can find ways which can give more certainty of our beliefs. Now, I particularly like the Cartesian method. And the first precept of Descartes is that you should only assume as true things that which you have no good reason to doubt. And I have no good reason to doubt the efficacy, the accuracy of science, because it is proven to me constantly by technology. Technology is a product of science. Technology has massively improved our lives. This is all evidence to show that science works. And there is no other way to put it. Science fucking works. And that's why I trust it. And that's why, even though I know that I cannot prove that it's absolutely true, I can trust it based on my experience of reality. Before I finish this video, I need to make a recommendation. A lot of it I learned from Sisyphus Redeemed in his absolutely amazing series of lectures about history and philosophy of science. It's one of the best things on YouTube. I'm putting a link to that in the description. And if you really care about this topic, if you are a scientist, a philosopher, or yeah, just care about it, you should really watch it. It's really, really worth your time. Well, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please leave it a like, a comment, share it, subscribe to my channel. A big, massive thank you to all of my subscribers, and an ultra massive thank you to all of my patrons. You guys are awesome. I've been Sarah Michelle. Once again, thank you for watching, and I shall see you next time. Cheers.